Welcome, everybody. As Ruby said, this is the last of our series of lectures, and I am very, very happy, and I feel very honored to be in the presence of these two wonderful filmmakers, James Soloman and Pieter-Jan De Pue. Let me introduce them to you. James, when he was a teenager, he interned in a newsroom. Okay, so, and he even went to journalism camps, okay, for our journalism students. He did the same thing. And at 20, he worked as a reporter for United Press International here in Hong Kong for 2 years, right? And later, he worked for two magazines in Australia. So, and then after that, he went back to the United States and went to Harvard College and American Film Institute, where he was a directing fellow. His first produced script was an episode of 100 Center Street, which was directed by Sidney Lumet. And this led to writing stints on television series, including the Emmy-winning The Practice. And in 1994, James and a friend of his stumbled upon a trial transcript that was a case in 1865. Of a group of conspirators who were to assassinate the then American president, Abraham Lincoln. And so based on the trial transcripts, he began working on a screenplay, and 15 years later, 15 years and countless draft, his screenplay was read by Robert Redford, who later produced and made it into a film. And you were the screenwriter of that. James is often drawn to projects requiring intensive research and reporting. He was a writer, executive producer of the acclaimed ESPN limited series, The Bronx is Burning, about the 1977 New York Yankees and the city of New York in turmoil. And then in the past 10 years, he has been working obsessively on a documentary film on the murder of Kitty Genovese. Is it Genovese? Genovese. And the film The Witness is being screened here at the film festival. And sitting next to him, Pieter-Jan De Pue, is from Belgium, and where he obtained his master's in audiovisual arts. His graduate thesis was a creative documentary titled, is it O or Zero? O. That received the United Nations Mediterranean Environmental Award and been screened at many film festivals in Europe and United States and in Beijing at the International Student Film and Video Festival. As a photographer, he has to many, many interesting places. He was in Palestine to document the life of a Palestinian family living under the Israeli occupation. And he was also in Brazil to photograph an indigenous community of the Amazon River. In 2007, he went to Afghanistan, where he was commissioned photographer for International Red Cross and the Caritas International. While he was there, he began working on a feature film, The Land of the Enlightened, which is a documentary with fictional elements. And the film took 7 years to make, was released just 2 weeks ago, March 16th, in Belgium. But already it has won the Best Cinematography Award at Sundance and World Cinema Documentary Special Jury Award at Rotterdam Film Festival. And it is here now being screened at the Hong Kong International Film Festival. So, welcome. And to begin with, I teach two courses here at the university, one in documentary appreciation and one in production. And in our classes, we often discuss the thin line between fiction and nonfiction in films. And coincidentally, both of you are dealing with these issues in your films and in your career. So, Pieter-Jan, your film has fiction and nonfictional elements. And James, your career in film covers both dramatic films and documentary films. And so I like to use this, the next hour and a half, to explore this a little further. And maybe we'll start with you first, James, because your career is, you know, outstanding and very interesting. Maybe you can tell our audience a little bit of how you straddle in between these two genres.
I'm just a lot older than firstly, it is really great, I think, for both of us to be here, and we're extraordinarily appreciative to the Documentary Initiative for inviting us. It's great to share the stage with such a extraordinary emerging talent in Peter, whose film is beautiful. If you haven't seen it, please do. It's really exquisite, and I think they've added even a screening of it after the festival. So folks should try to check it out. It's quite beautiful. Haunting, really. When I was here last in Hong Kong, I had a full head of hair. So it gives you an idea of how long it's been. And it is really thrilling, absolutely thrilling to be back. Is anyone in this room 20 years old? There's one person. So all of you are older or younger? Some of you are younger. Younger. You're all younger. So I was that old 20-year-old man when I was working here as a journalist and starry-eyed journalist covering Asia for an American wire service. As Nancy rightly said, and I learned more about myself from her introduction, so I learned some things I didn't even know, things that I'd lived. The idea of journalism has always been a central part of the work that I do, sort of questioning, exploring the truth. Typically what I'm drawn to are stories we think we know. They are kind of iconic stories that we all know, come to, have sort of shaped the way we see the world, but aren't necessarily narratives that are entirely factual. And I think probably in this room, many of you have even in your own personal lives, narratives that may be false narratives that have shaped your own life. It could be even a photograph that sits in your living room that you have shaped a whole story around. So I began, the transition for me into filmmaking was through journalism. And as Nancy rightly said, the first film that I made took me 18 years to get made. The President Lincoln, as many of you know, is the most famous American president, but every American is taught that he was shot in a theater by one man, and that was the end of the story. He was assassinated, the first American president to be assassinated. It's one man shot. And I learned what anyone could learn was that actually it was a broader conspiracy. I am drawn to not statues, but the people behind stories and the lives that people have led, the people who were impacted by actual historical events or real events. So I'll show a clip, a trailer, to give you an idea of the work that I started with, which was The Conspirator. It's a couple minutes long, and this was the trailer that accompanied the movie that came out in 2011. It premiered, it was directed by Robert Redford, and I don't know how many people know who Robert Redford is. Does everybody in this, because some people don't. Robert Redford is the founder of the Sundance Institute, but he was the most famous actor in the world for about a 15-year period. And he won an Academy Award as a director. This is a movie that he directed that, as Nancy said, took 18 years. I'm drawn to, this is a scripted project, and that was obviously with actors, and some of them are famous actors. I'm drawn, though, to stories of dramas of conscience, of sort of questions of what do we owe each other? What are our responsibilities to each other? In the late 1990s, I learned of a story that was a very seminal, important crime that had taken place in New York in the early 1960s. On March 13, 1964, a woman named Kitty Genovese was coming home, 28 years old, was coming home from where she worked early in the morning, and she was brutally attacked. At first, the murder of Kitty Genovese was reported as in four paragraphs inside the newspaper. 2 weeks later, the New York Times reported on its front page that 38 people, for over a half hour had watched as this woman was attacked three times and not one person had called the police. And she became, in a sense, the symbol of urban apathy, of people not getting involved. And as a result of her murder, it helped inspire the 911 emergency system in New York, Good Samaritan laws, neighborhood watch groups. It's even credited with having some influence on the US invasion of Iraq in the early 2000s. It is a case that is taught in every psych and sociology class in the United States. People not getting involved. So I was very drawn to this as a story about conscience. What do we do in moments of conscience? In the late 1990s, I set out to write a screenplay for HBO, because that's what I do, I'm a screenwriter. And in the course of researching it, I started to meet some people, and the one person who I met had the most profound effect on me was her brother, Bill Genovese, 12 years younger than Kitty, who had not just been affected by the death of this sister who he was so close to, but by the way she reportedly died. And he had made some choices, profound choices, that irrevocably changed the course of his life. The film did not happen, as happens in more screenplays you write don't get produced. And I was still haunted by this story. And in 2004, the New York Times questioned its own story, whether 38 had actually seen or heard what had actually happened. And Bill Genovese was motivated to find out for himself what actually happened. That's what The Witness is about. It is the story of the unraveling of the mythic death and forgotten life of Kitty Genovese. So the first clip in the film is this I'm going to show you, which is clip number two, Seeking the Truth. And that is Bill setting out on his journey that unravels over the course of 11 years and in real time, and essentially unfolds in real time in the course of the film.
And this is documentary.
Sorry, yes, to be clear. So I followed Bill, so that's the transition. So now, instead of making a film where I'm scripting what people found out, I actually, in a sense, decided better to actually learn from the people who lived this story directly. And that's what this film is. It's a documentary. Bill Genovese gathers all the documents he can find. Now, how do you make that visual? The next clip, which is clip number three on your up there, trial transcript, is one of the ways, one of the devices that was used to illuminate what Bill is finding during the course of his journey, and tell you a little bit about how we found the animator who did this. Bill Genovese is learning for the first time that his sister was actually not alone when she died. A story that has endured at this point for 40 years, because it's now 50 years, but at 40 years, he didn't know, his family didn't know, that Kitty actually died in the arms. They thought she was left alone. Well, you can imagine how that changes your feeling if that's the story that's been told. She's the most famous person who was abandoned, and basically she wasn't. She was not alone. So Bill locates the person in whose arms Kitty died. Her name is Sophia, and Sophia initially isn't willing to meet with Bill. So he meets his son, Michael. And that is clip number four. The majority of you here are journalism students. Bill is not a journalist. He is what one would call a truth seeker, the ultimate truth seeker. And as I was explaining to someone earlier, he was a scout in the army. Bill has a lot at stake to find out the truth about what happened to his sister, not only because it was the defining story of his sister, life, in a sense, because her life was erased by 30 minutes of her death. She's only known, really, for the way she died. But also because Bill is in a wheelchair, a double amputee, as a result of that story. And you find out in the course of the film that, in fact, that story propelled Bill to prove that he wasn't like one of those so-called 38 witnesses. And so he volunteered, he enlisted in the Marines, and he went to Vietnam. And that's where he lost both of his legs, trying to prove that he wasn't like one of those witnesses. So when you begin to, when you're Bill, and this is 12 minutes into the film, and you find out that in fact the central tenet of a story that no one helped your sister is undermined by the fact that someone actually was there when your sister died, it makes you question the whole story. So what propels Bill on the rest of his journey, and I know I think I've used my allotted time, so is, and then I can show you other clips later, whatever, but is that Bill, propelled by the central tenet of a story not being true, attempts to then not only unravel what actually happened that night, but who his sister, this whose life was forgotten, how this story came to be, why journalists, so he tracks down the journalists who covered this story, so why this story was covered this way, and to find the killer who killed his sister, who is unbelievably still alive, 52 years later in jail, the longest serving inmate in New York State prison, and to meet him. That is what The Witness is about. And the reason the film is called The Witness, in a sense, is, and as journalists, you are all bearing witness to a certain kind of truth. And the film, as I mentioned at the outset, and what interests me is about narratives, real and imagined, that shape our lives. Bill has lived with a story that has shaped his life that isn't necessarily a truthful, accurate story, but it's real and has shaped his life, so it's as real as any story. And I think as a journalist, you would find probably very inspiring, in a sense, what this one individual decided and was able to do through force of will and need to challenge a story that has lived, in a sense, for a half century, and to unravel it because he needed to unravel it.
Thank you. Thank you for... Pieter-Jan, tell us about how you come from being a world-traveling photographer to making this film and spent 7 years with this film.
Yeah. So as I said in the interview right before, so I graduated from the film school in 2006 in Brussels, and I started working as a photographer, mainly for humanitarian organizations in Afghanistan. And while working for those humanitarian organizations, I discovered like a lot of little stories of children who were trying to survive in the war in Afghanistan. Some of them were digging up mines, like anti-personnel mines, anti-tank mines. Some of them were dealing scrap metal, or some of them were dealing actually with the Afghan army, the American army, for gathering like unexploded munition or shells and brass to get money out of it. And so when I came back home in the end of 2007, I was very convinced about, what really touched me was, the great resilience of those kids. So I decided to go back to Afghanistan and maybe to think about writing a script about them. And then, I came back to Afghanistan in the first place to understand also Afghanistan much more, because while thinking about making a script about those kids, I needed to know also much more about the background of this country. So I kept on exploring with my photo camera. And I came back to those kids that I met the year before, but still doing photo reports for humanitarian organizations, but more focused on the world of those kids. And so I came back with much more detailed material. And in 2008, I also went the first time with the American Army embedded to have like an idea how this conflict in Afghanistan looked like, especially near the Pakistani border. I made a huge photo reportage about it, but still on photo. And then I had much more knowledge than about what was going on in Afghanistan, and I wanted to tell the world of the kids in Afghanistan, but embedded in this conflict. And I wanted to tell the conflict through their eyes. So that was actually the beginning of the script. So from there on, we start writing with a script doctor. And in 2010, we went the first time back to Afghanistan with a very small crew, with a sound engineer, to shoot the first part of the film, which was actually the American Army Taliban part. So we got embedded with an American unit for a couple of months near the Pakistani border, and we captured this this war in general, so on a full documentary way. At the end of 2010, we went back to Belgium. We edited like some of the rushes of this material that we shot, and we made a first teaser about the film, or what was going to be the film, actually. And we presented this teaser at a lot of film markets, like which were parts from at some festivals, like the Leipzig Film Festival, also with ITVA in the Netherlands. And we pitched the story about the kids of Afghanistan. But a lot of commissioning editors, they were really interested to participate in this project. But obviously, the first question was like, okay, you want to tell a story about Afghan kids in a war, but you're showing me only US soldiers fighting. So where are the kids? And of course, they were true. So in 2011, we came back to Afghanistan to focus on the world of the kids and do a lot of tryouts with the kids and make a second teaser with them. That should be the outcome of the 1 year preparation, actually. So I went back to all those locations where those kids were involved in their this kind of surviving economy with a sound engineer, and we did like lots of first tries with kids and tried to tell their story and make a second teaser. So it's 2011 was a very difficult year, because with the American Army it was kind of easy, you know, like in that sense that the army was providing like all logistics. They organize everything for you. You jump on a helicopter, you take your gear with the helicopter, they give you food, they protect you. I mean, even Afghanistan is a difficult country. You're kind of comfortable with them. But then when we were together with those kids in the middle of the mountains, we were alone. And I learned very fast, because I was only with some Afghan friends, that making a film on this, you know, in this hard conditions without any logistical support would be very hard. So that was one lesson that we learned in 2011. But anyway, after 4 months, we had enough material to make a second teaser. We pitched it again at ITVA and some other film festivals, and lots of commissioning editors, they believed in it. They said, okay, it gives a very good view, point of view on what you want to tell. And especially I wanted to tell in the film the imagination and the projections and the fantasies of those kids and what they were thinking, what was going to happen with them and with Afghanistan after the withdrawal of the NATO and the American army. And I think this layer pushed me also towards a kind of a hybrid film, because I wanted to visualize as well their projections and their dreams. So, and of course, if you're gonna like start making a dream visual, then you're going into a kind of a fiction style. And we were mixing this up. We knew from the very beginning that we were going to mix this up with images from the hard reality on the field, and which was shot in a very documentary style, and especially the parts with the army. But you know, a lot of commissioning editors, they said, okay, nice, let's start with it and let's finance the project. So 2012 was kind of research, doing, checking out for these locations logistically, how we gonna deal with it. So trying to organize a crew, trying to make deals with the Ministry of Culture, with Afghan Film, the Ministry of Interior, and all the local powers and tribal leaders in Afghanistan at the locations where we wanted to film. And this seemed not so easy, but anyway, in 2013 we decided to start shooting the film. But we made a very big mistake in that sense that in 2011, when we were doing the first tryouts with the kids and when I was alone, I had such a headache about this bureaucracy, this corruption, this paperwork, and all this stuff. So I said, a production leader has to take this away from me so I can focus on the kids with my camera. And but we were looking a long time for a production manager, and we did not find them, especially not in Europe. Because, there, I mean, there have been not made like long films or fiction-style films in such remote areas in Afghanistan. So anyway, we decided to continue with an Afghan production manager, but he also was not very aware where we wanted to film in very remote areas. He was only knowing about Kabul. But we left anyway, and we thought, okay, we're going to solve this issue by having a big crew with a lot of European crew who is going to take like lots of, you know, things from my shoulders, so I could be very flexible in my work. And by doing so, we ended up very big, with too much equipment, too much cars, too visible. And at some point in 2013, we got attacked by Taliban. And luckily, nobody died, but a lot of people got wounded, lots of gear got destroyed. And we had to be evacuated back to Belgium. The whole script fell into pieces, and the production wanted to stop the film. And then, I spent so many years already in Afghanistan, I really wanted to tell this film. So the production asked me, okay, Peter, you want to continue? We'll give you one chance more, and you just go to Afghanistan with the remaining budget and do your thing. And but you go alone without any European crew because the insurance didn't want to cover Europeans anymore. So I came back to Afghanistan, and I knew if I wanted to make this film possible, I should make this film possible only with Afghans. But Afghans, you know, this is a country 40 years in war, so there is no cinema, there is no even no journalism, there is nothing. I mean, they have like a faculty of cinema, but it's only like some theory that they're learning about history of cinema, so they, even a 5D or just like a photo camera, they don't know it. And we were shooting with film, you know, on 60 millimeter and 35 millimeter, and professional gear, so it was a very big challenge for them to learn that. So I started looking for the most motivated people of my crew, and I think motivation was the main thing that was looking for, not their technical knowledge. And and we worked like for a couple of months. We kind of formed like a key group. And we had many plans. We had an A plan, and B plan, and C plan. And if A plan was not working, we would jump to C plan and then to F plan. And we were in touch all the time with the editor about this. So I forgot, before I left to Afghanistan, I start rewriting the script based also in this. I mean, that I rewrote it in that sense that I could do it myself with Afghans. So. Again, so we left with very few people, with a very small amount of equipment, one car, with a lot of plans. And I think in 2014, the only condition was that we needed to have a lot of time, because Afghanistan is a country which is very slowly. They don't know cinema. Even if you want to make cinema, they think you're trying to create a reality or something. What you're doing is reality. So. It was very strange also for them to know what our plans were. And so in 2014, we left, and we ended up like almost being there for 7 months in one shooting block. And we came back with a film. But it was a kind of a struggle. So let's see, I will show the first three clips. I will show them one after each other. There are three different parts of the film. Then I will tell a bit about it, and then we can see some other extracts. So I just want to tell a bit about the hybrid structure, because a lot of questions are coming up about this approach. So it's first of all, I wanted to tell a film about Afghanistan with Afghans, and especially about the dreams of those kids. So as I mentioned before, I knew from the very beginning if I'm going to visualize these dreams that it was going to be a hybrid film anyway. But during the preparation of this film, I discovered a lot of small stories of kids who were saying, for example, one told me, I remember in the beginning in 2008 or 2009, someone said to me, yeah, when the Americans are going back home, I will become the king of Afghanistan and I will grab power and I'm gonna take the palace and I'm gonna live there with my queen, with my girl, and we're gonna rule Afghanistan and I will have a big group of friends on horseback who are gonna protect me and my queen and my palace. Another was saying, okay, when the Americans are going back, if the Americans are gonna stay here and fight the Taliban much more, and even the Taliban is gonna rule maybe in the future our country, then I'm gonna escape from Afghanistan with my horse and with my girl on the back of the horse, and I'm gonna ride towards the stars. Another one was saying, I'm gonna marry the most beautiful girl of Afghanistan, and I will find a lot of opium because the father apparently of the girl was opium addicted, and I'm gonna give him like 5 kilograms of opium, and then he will be agree that I can marry his girl. So all little stories like this I discovered during the preparation, and of course, they were based on their dreams and also based on reality in Afghanistan, but it was really difficult to find those kids back because they grew up or they disappeared or they moved to another place in Afghanistan. So I collected all those little stories and I decided to look for one main character, Ghulam Nasir, the little boy that you see in the film, and to hang on all these ideas and all those dreams on him. And that he would become a kind of a translator or like a kind of a performer who is the voice of all these dreams of Afghan kids. And that's one of the reasons why we stage so many things with Ghulam Nasir, but again, based on a reality that I wanted to tell in Afghanistan. So the two last clips that you're going to see are parts with the American army, which is, as I told before, completely reality. So it's like we were embedded with them for a couple of months and we shot everything like it was in daily life. So the boredom, but also the fights that they had every day with the Taliban, the helicopters, the transports and whatever. And then the last clip you're going to see is a reflection, a historical reflection of the Soviet times. Maybe, I don't know, you remember this, but in the 80s, the Soviet army was also in Afghanistan, much way before the Mujahideen and the American times. And so they occupied Afghanistan, and a lot of Russian soldiers made a lot of music about their time that they were in Afghanistan. And we took a song, a Russian song, of a soldier who spent like a couple of years in Afghanistan and who is reflecting back on his experiences he had in Afghanistan. And this song, we sticked on a scene where the American army decides to leave. So it's actually a reflection on the Americans today and with a message that actually nothing happened there is no difference between the war between the Soviets and the Americans today in Afghanistan. It's the same perspective, the same, I mean, the war looks really is very similar in all different kind of ways. So we're going to show those two clips and then let's do the Q&A maybe.
Okay, well,
Can I make a comment just, Nancy?
Sure, yes.
Observation. It's interesting when you see two films and they, on the face of it, look very, very different. They seem to be about very different subjects. The approaches are very different. Clearly, Peter's film is very sensation about, you know, the dust, the feeling, the tactile aspects of a place, and it's dreamlike. And my film is The Witness is rooted very much more in information and gathering of information. But what I'm really struck by in watching your clips is how much both subjects are about casualties of war and the resilience. The subject of my film is a guy whose family was blown apart by an extraordinarily tragic, violent death, and the film explores the aftermath of an act of violence over on a family over a half century, and a man who has lost his legs by that violent act, and is dealing in his own very cerebral way. The film gets to a point towards the end of an emotional catharsis, but it is a man who is holding it inside. Your film, as I'm watching it, is people who are in the midst of the creation of casualties of war, both the servicemen, but of course, even more profoundly, the children and the people who live there, and as you say, the resiliency. But it is interesting, these are subjects, and I wonder, you know, if you were to visit your subjects 50 years from now, as grown adults, how they would have processed, because what we're watching in The Witness is a film about a man processing something that happened 50 years ago and how it still holds him. And I just thought sometimes when you look at two films, they don't seem at all related. And I was just watching and thinking, oh, that's kind of interesting.
Yes, yes. And I find it very interesting too. As I said earlier, what I like to explore is the fictional and the non-fictional side of it too. And that's really very much of a creative process as a filmmaker. And I'd like to start with you first, James. I mean, when you made...
Just interrupt you. Can I go 2 minutes to toilet?
Sure, please.
I'll be right back. But I have to go urgently.
I'll come back to you for another question, okay? Yes. Do you know where the bathroom is?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. I was just thinking when watching your film is...
By the way, as documentarians, that's the moment you'll remember. It's true. It's the unexpected. And I just want to, Nancy, just want to point out, I mean, what you heard from the two of us, we both set out to make something else and ended up making these films. That wasn't our intention. Sort of the accident. And in filmmaking, it is the accident of what happens that you don't anticipate. And that's the memorable moment, right? A person, that's the human moment. Somebody in a room, we're in a room where not documentary filmmakers are not necessarily used to lecturing, and we sort of have to. So, I just mentioned. Sorry.
There's only so much you can hold. Yes, right. So, I'm just curious because you've written scripts before, and you have looked at trials transcripts, and then you have made that into a fictional story, and then while working at The Witness, you're working with. You know, reality and non-fictional stuff, and at you did it for so many years. You know, and did any time you felt like this is a little restricting for me? If I can just write out the scene, if there are you know people that I can put in some lines or something in there, are there moments like that?
Boy, what a great question. So, they're actually sort of unpacked your question because there are a couple of questions in there. The one question is. So when I wrote The Conspirator, I only wished I could have actually met the real people, but it happened, The Conspirator, the movie about the Lincoln assassination, it happened in 1865, so it's more than 150 years ago, so I wouldn't have been able to interview them. So I approached it as a reporter trying to investigate a story, but the closest I could get to interviewing was through diaries, and by the way, that's hugely helpful. Diaries is where you hear real voices, and so that's how I went about scripting it. So what a relief to actually be able to talk. Now it's 52 years now, the Kitty Genovese murder, 1964 is when that happened, but thankfully a number of those people, key people, are still alive, so I was able to, in a sense, do what I couldn't do with The Conspirator. The question you asked is it frustrating sometimes when real life doesn't cooperate exactly the way you would hope? Firstly, I'm a screenwriter, and just between the group of us, who doesn't really love writing screenplays. So it's such a relief when someone else is writing the dialogue. For me, is actually living it. So when I'm filming two people talking and I didn't have to write it for them, what a relief. So that's a huge relief. The other thing is there's a scene, and I don't know if this in this section we can show things, scenes,
well,
but...
we don't have much time, and I also would like to open the floor for questions.
So there is a scene in the film where Bill Genovese meets the son of his sister's murder. And in the course of that scene, real life, he ends up saying to him, are you a member of the crime family, the Genovese crime family, which is one of the most famous crime families? And we learn in the course of the scene that this man, the son of the murderer, has thought for 50 years that Bill Genovese and the Kitty Genovese was part of a crime family. And when he came to meet with Bill in the film, in a hotel room, he thought he was going to be murdered. He really felt that way. In fact, it's not even in the film, but the level of anxiety was so great that the whole family, the man's whole family thought that he was going to die that day. I could never have scripted that. Never would have thought about that. So, yes, to answer your question truthfully, Nancy, and yes, there are times when you would hope that the camera didn't break, or you were able to that the performance was a little bit more emotional or something. But there are often so many things that happen that you can't expect. You just have to be more patient. And so we shoot hundreds and hundreds of hours. Now, what's interesting, Peter's case is he shot 35 and 16, which is so seldom done. Documentaries, 35 millimeter, incredibly expensive and very difficult, and also doing it there and trying to get it processed and all that. So it even creates more restrictions. I do think what's interesting also is about the fiction, nonfiction. Peter has a little more latitude, I think, to sort of take liberties with what's real and what's not, I think you used the word staged, I think you said. Bill Genovese is taking on journalism institutions like the New York Times, Mike Wallace, CBS News. I don't think he has the latitude to, we didn't have the latitude to fictionalize, because his credibility was so essential that the film required us heed to a certain kind of authenticity. And if the audience thinks that this is staged, then we'll have a problem in challenging. There is only one moment in the film when something is staged. It happens at the end, but it is built by Bill's design. And to let you know, we've obviously run out of time, I have a clip, but is that he actually stages his sister's murder so that he can experience emotionally what it was like. That's how far Bill wants to go in order to find the truth. But that's that's the only staging that takes place in the film.
Pieter-Jan, I'm very interested in when you were editing the film. So you have all this material of documentary footage of the military. And how do you find a way of structuring and integrating the stories of the boys with it? And sometimes, you know, I was watching the film the first time, and I said, is this an actor or is this not an actor? I was actually quite confused, because you did it so well, almost like seamlessly, the scenes, yes.
It's first of all, when we were with the Americans in 2010, we discovered that kids were trading with the American army, and I was not expecting that. It was something that was completely unknown. I wanted to make a context of the war, and then embedding the story of the kids. But I never realized that kids were coming up that actual outpost to deal brass for bread, and they were even selling small monkeys alive to the American soldiers. But also they were trading hash for Afghan soldiers, and so they were doing a lot of commercial activities with them. So for me, that was a first direct step coming from the conflict to dive into the world of the kids. But actually what bound the editing much more, or brought the two sides much more together, was that both parties were thinking about the other one, but never seeing them. For example, the Americans, you saw Cleves, the American soldiers, he's like fantasizing what was going to happen with the brass after they were firefighting, the brass of the machine guns. And he was thinking, okay, those kids, they are taking off the brass from us. They will melt it down, make IDs of it. They will sell it to the Taliban. They will probably bring it to Pakistan and whatever, you know. So and he was even fantasizing, yeah, when I will come back to Afghanistan, I will have an army of children. So he had like this whole imagination. And you have to know, these soldiers, they were stationed like 50 months on a mountaintop, and only the only thing that, the only relationship that they had with Afghanistan was the view inside the valley. So they were only kind of imagining what Afghan life would be and how those kids would live, but they never saw them, you know. So the same thing happened with the kids. If you want to see, if you're going to see the film, or if you want to see the film, it's you're going to see a lot of scenes where Ghulam Nasir and his group are listening to a radio, where they listen to the voice of Barack Obama, who's saying, okay, we're going to pull out from Afghanistan. And even his voice is translated in Farsi, so they understand what he's saying. And so by his voice, they are thinking about the American army, and they have expectations they have, they are suggesting what they are doing, but it's all about projections and imaginary world. And I think those two projections from the U.S. Army towards the kids and the kids towards the U.S. Army was just the interesting part to bind them and to bring them close together. And this was something that we really had to focus on in the editing, and that's why that was actually on our main guideline to the whole editing process.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'll ask one more question, and then working in films that take so long to finish, what were maybe some of the factors that kept you going? Both of you, yes.
I think your relationship, if you work on something for a very long time, and there are two films that I worked on for over 10 years, and your relationship to the subject changes as you develop. So for the case of The Conspirator, I wrote about a mother-son relationship in a way, and I was 28 at the time writing about the quasi-son when I started, and by the time I finished the film, I was closer to the age of the mother figure in her 40s. So you sort of evolve and your perspective changes. In this, in The Witness, it was without question, and I think Nancy knows where I'm probably going with this, I started off making a film about a brother who lost a sister, about sibling loss. And it was and that idea of loss was completely abstract to me. I didn't know it. It was empathetic. I appreciated the loss, but I didn't know it personally. But in the course of making a film about a brother who lost a sister, my brother, my only sibling, and the person who I looked up to more than anyone in the world, got sick and was diagnosed with leukemia and died. So sometimes life follows art follows life. And so that propelled me more than anything to finish the film. I was making a film initially about an investigation, but it was ultimately a film about loss.
For me, it's you know, as I told before, it was a big struggle to make this film with a lot of ups and downs. But especially after the attack in Afghanistan in 2013, I was so convinced about the story of those kids. And their strong resilience that the more I stayed with them and the more time I spent with them and I talked with them, and the more I learned their language and I could communicate in a very, very close way with them, the stronger our relationship became. And so the more I was convinced that I had to make the story, even we got attacked in 2013, I said, yeah, I have to continue with this project. You know, Afghanistan, it became at some point also, we, especially me, but I think some other crew members too, but especially me, we became so embedded in this culture that at some point we were getting to know Afghanistan so well, and we were starting to think as Afghans. You know, we were really you know, we were thinking, okay, where is the Taliban operating this area? So we have to drive this way, and we were like the same kind of, and I mean, we were so absorbed in this culture that we had to go until the very end. It seemed so obvious. It was
come so far already.
Yeah,
Might as well just go through it, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
And but that made the end so hard too, because at some point the film shoot stops, you know, and then you have to go back home and you have to edit the film, and then you end up in an editing suit, and it's like you get a bit crazy, but it's. I think it's just that Afghanistan gives you also so much positive energy. Afghanistan is not only negative things, and that's also something I wanted to express in the film, that there is a message of hope and of light and of something positive thinking, and this was also reflecting to me. These people have a very positive way of looking towards life, and that was the positive energy that came to us to continue with the project.
And you end the film very positively. They found their palace.
Yeah,
yes.
That's it.
How many of you have, can we have the house lights now? How many of you have seen the film? Have seen either one of the films now? Okay. Yes, okay. All right,
how many of you want to see the film?
Yeah, great, yes.
Both or just one?
Both, right? Yes. They're really amazing films. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. It's actually worth, how will people, if they don't get to see it now, how will they get to see your film? Do you know?
I don't know. It's no, but it's gonna come on Netflix anyway, because Netflix bought the rights, and then but it will go to Japan Film Festival too, and probably to Busan.
Busan.
Busan
in Korea.
So, but
yes.
This is like in October, I think.
Yeah.
So, but and Hong Kong, I don't know.
Uh-huh. Will it go to Beijing again?
I don't know.
Or Shanghai?
Mm-hmm. It depends. But let's see what the distribution is going to do here. Maybe there is going to be a release. And anyway, it will come on DVD. So. Mm-hmm.
And The Witness will open in America theatrically probably in June, being distributed. And then it will be on Netflix worldwide. My guess is probably in the fall. And I don't know I think they're sort of working out sort of deals around the world for...
We'll probably get it next year. Netflix. We just have Netflix, so... But we don't get everything that the States have. But it wait a little bit, a few months, but we'll get it. Yes. Okay.
Well, if you guys clamor for these films, maybe...
Yes. Questions, please?
We certainly will be more than happy to host both screen here at Hong Kong U, so we'll explore that.
Thank you.
Okay. Don't be shy, yes?
Okay, thank you. Thank you for both of you. The word that occurred in my mind when I see the clips for both of the film is humanity in a positive way. My question may be a little stupid, I think, for Peter. Do you think the kids in your film as actors, they may have the chance to watch the film during their lifetime? I have fiction in my mind that if someday they may watch the film, they might have, I believe they may feel the care from you and your colleagues, and maybe also from the care from audience, like quite normal and common people like me as a member of human being. Thank you very much for your efforts.
Thank you. Just to reply on your question, we are right now organizing a screening in two screenings in Afghanistan. So we're going to bring the film end of the summer to Kabul for an Afghan premiere, but which is in the first place for the Ministry of Culture, Afghan Film, so it's also a part of the Ministry of Culture, and some other ministries, NGOs, and a lot of embassies who cooperated with the film, and of course all the crew members who are coming from Kabul. But for the kids, it's another story, of course. And that's why after that, we will organize a mobile cinema and we will go with the mobile cinema into the mountains of the place where Golem Nasir lives with his boys. And we'll be going to screen the film in open air for the three villages, because it's not only the kids, it's like it was a huge organization of supplies with a lot of villagers cooperated with us to make this shoot possible. So it were actually three villages close to each other. And we're going to bring back all the people together, and we're going to organize one big open air screening. And this is going to be filmed as well for the end of the making of, because we have a making of film as well. And which is my kind of finalized this version, but it's there gonna be some more annexes, and I think the ending part of the making of is the screening in the mountains. But it's gonna be kind of a complicated organization, because from Kabul towards the mountains, it's a long trajectory. It's like 3 days driving. And that's why there are a lot of provinces controlled by Taliban, so we can't do it. So that's why we need to go by another road, by Tajikistan. So we have to go out of Afghanistan to go through the mountains of Tajikistan to come inside Afghanistan again. So it's gonna be a big organization on level of border crossing with all the equipment. But we were right now dealing with the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of France and Goethe Institute from Germany to make this possible. So that's our next trip to Afghanistan. So the kids will definitely see it.
What do you think their response will be?
As I told before, it's for them, it's really hard to understand what cinema is, because they don't know this medium. They never, for example, they never watched the screen. You know, they never saw a laptop or a phone, or there is nothing there. There is not any connection. So everything that you have to do on level of communication is with satellite phones, and they don't have it because it's way too expensive. So last year I was in Afghanistan with a rough cut of the film, because I had to record the voice of the boy, and I came back there and I showed him a rough cut of the film, and he saw it with only two friends, and they were watching the screen, and at some point they were scared, and at some point they were laughing with themselves, and it was very, very strange for them, but very interesting, you know. They were so I think the screening will be a lot of fun, definitely, because for them it will be also, and not only for the kids, but for a lot of village elders even, it will be a first meeting with moving image and cinema. So that's why I think the making of is going to be very interesting to make.
You should bring Belgium TV to go and cover that event.
Sure, I think, yeah. No, we had some good reviews in Belgium about the film, so I think if we're going to release the making of, they will be interested to do something about it, I think.
Great. Yes. Another question?
I'm glad Nancy has mentioned your film, Peter's film, has positive attitude, element, for the story, but I'm concerned for the local people when they watch the situation, maybe they will think of negatively. So when you show to them, I think better have let them to know you created a positively, yeah, and help them to get more comfort, yeah.
Yes, it depends where. I think in Kabul, I think there will be less people interested to watch the film in Kabul, because in Kabul people are much more educated and they are much more aware about the circumstances of Afghanistan today. And it's, of course, I'm telling a lot about the reality in Afghanistan. Even I'm bringing a kind of a hopeful message. But a lot of Afghans today, they don't want to see again on the screen what the reality in their country looks like. So I think, and that's why in Kabul, I'm sure that less people will be interested than the kids in the mountains, because for them it's like a new world that's gonna open. And you know, also you have to know, during the shoot with the kids, they had a lot of fun, you know. So they spend, like, we had so much, me too, you know, we spent 3 months together, and they were always on their horseback and shooting with their rifles, and we were doing all kind of funny stuff with them. And even it was their life, but playing their life for a camera, for them it was really enjoyable. So I think when they're gonna watch it again on the screen, it has nothing to do with a negative sense. So it's gonna be just fun for them, I think. So they will love it, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm. Yes, there's a question there.
I have a question for James. How much would you say have you impacted the progress of your story, in particular the brother going to meet the son of the person who found the girl, and for him to take those steps? Was it more your initiative, or were you just at the right time at the right moment?
It's such a good question, and it's the question that I think every documentary filmmaker needs to address. I think every journalist addresses that question. How much are we changing the reality or affecting the reality? You know, it's interesting, in Peter's case, he's very open about it. The film, I don't recall, but I don't think the film acknowledges at the center, at the beginning, that when that boy is opening the ordinance, for example, it says these are actors.
Those kids are, how would I say, they were living in that minefield, and you saw the kid, his legs were blown off, so he was like digging up these mines on a daily basis. I mean, this was his work. But of course, working with a film crew in an active minefield was kind of irresponsible, so we took a part of the minefield, which was the mine, and we put like deactivated mines back in the ground, and we said to the kids, just do your thing.
No, but it's actually an interesting question, because it gets the thrust of your question in a way, and I'll answer it directly with in my film, which is, when you're, as an audience member, when you're watching that moment, there's a set of a tension, an inherent tension, if it's actual or if it's staged. If you know it's staged, then it changes, in a sense, the kind of danger element. But it doesn't necessarily undermine the film. It just changes a reality. And I guess a question, because it's a documentary, whether you need to acknowledge that from the center so that the audience is in on it, because you're in on it. And I think it's one of the really good questions, and I'll talk about it specifically as it relates to my film. I begin the film by acknowledging it's a film by James Soloman. I don't love that credit. I think there's something kind of pompous about it, because the film is, Peter is referred to as a collaborative effort of so many people. But at the very front of the film, I say it's a film by James Soloman, because Bill Genovese is actually narrating this story. There's no presence of the filmmaker essentially on screen, but you wonder, well, Bill's not he's not a filmmaker. And so I acknowledge that there is a filmmaker's hand. But to speak to your very point, I don't think there are a lot of things, I have to acknowledge there are a lot of things that happened in the film that Bill probably wouldn't have done if he wasn't in collaboration with a filmmaker who had the resources, the knowledge, the experience to sort of make those things happen. But did Bill want to meet with his sister's killer? Absolutely. Did he know how to do it? Yeah, he did. Did we talk about how to do it? Sure. And did it happen? And we talked about this in the interview. If it doesn't happen on film, it doesn't really exist as a reality in a film. It's not helpful for him to say, hey, I had a really interesting conversation last week with a son of my sister's killer, because the audience goes, well, that's really interesting. But so it happens on film, therefore it is controlled. You've got to light it, you got to be there. We followed Bill into every scene, except for one. So he governed what we did. We didn't do anything without his, not only collaboration, but it's explicit. He wanted to do it. But I have to readily acknowledge that there are things that he might not have done, including recreating his sister's murder. Would he have known to hire an actress? How to do it? But that was very much a collaboration between a filmmaker and a subject of the film, but he chose to do it, wanted to do it, and there were conversations. So if that, does that answer your question?
Yeah, it does. I mean, as you said, I think the want, or that he really wanted to explore this further, was a conversation, and that's why you're putting your title close to it, because you through the conversation he gets to the bottom of what he really wants to do and how he wants to explore the story further.
And you know, there are two truths that are going on. There's a narrative truth, but there's also an emotional truth. That emotional truth is his. And what he's processing, what he's experiencing, what he's reacting to, how he reacts to the moment, that's all him. He's in front of the camera. I'm not. His natural reaction when the man says to him, the son says to him, are you a member of the crime? When his son says, the son says to him in the film, your sister, I thought that your sister, my understanding of what happened when my father killed your sister is that your sister used racial slurs, and that's why he murdered her. And Bill Genovese's reaction in that scene is Bill. It's not me. And his reaction, that's not what happened, but the way he reacts is totally him. So the situation, sure, it certainly helped. He wanted to meet him, but no question that a filmmaker is affecting reality.
We have time for one more question, because this hall will be closed soon. Yes, there's one up there at the top. Yes.
Thank you so much for your films. I really like the films from both of you. I have one question for Peter, because recently we're doing the documentary film assignment from Nancy. So one problem we're facing with is actually the visualization of film. So since you have been working as a photographer, is there any experience that you can share with us how to better visualize the film and how to better combine all those artistic elements into the film? That's it. Thank you.
Of course, since I'm doing a lot of photography, I've always loved making images myself. So even for my graduate project, it was a big conflict between me and my cameraman, you know. So I was making the frames of the camera, and actually at the very end, he just had to push record and stop, you know. So it became a kind of tense between us. But the advice to give you, I think you just be curious to make interesting frames and try to compose frames in a very interesting way. I think I learned from one of my teachers at the school, even he was a director, he was not a cameraman. He said to our class, like, whenever you frame something and you take like a still out of this shot, it should be like a picture. It should be like a picture that you want to keep in your photo album. It should be something that you're really interested to watch. So it should have like a whole composition of depth and of lots of elements, and it should be really interesting to watch and to analyze what's happening in it. But it's really difficult to tell you what or how, because also this film in Afghanistan, it's much more handheld shoot than I expected from the very beginning, because my style is rather fixed and I like to make beautiful shots in a very static way. But then little by little, I discovered that Afghanistan is not that perfect. You know, it's a very rough country. It's brutal. The life of the children is very hard. There is a war going on. The air is full of dust. Everything is difficult. So that's why I came up with a format, first of all, that we want to shoot on 60 millimeter, because it has this grain and it has this rough look, if you want. Digital would be too perfect and too crisp and too nice, you know, and too sharp. And then secondly, because of this roughness in Afghanistan, we decided to shoot much more handheld than expected, because we wanted to follow the kids that unexpected way, because they were moving very unexpectedly, and sometimes they had to grab something here, and then they were diving to mine there. So, by following this, we were just making this image even stronger, just to miss it. You know, it was a kind of a style that we invented in Afghanistan itself because of the conditions in Afghanistan. So, I can't tell you, this is nice and this is not nice. It's something you have to experience yourself, I think, by doing a lot. But I just said in the interview, I think they asked me a similar question, how to make beautiful images. And I think one advice that I can give is just be curious all the time and try things and see what works and follow your feeling. And I think at some point you will come there. Making images is something that you have to do. You can't really learn. You can learn the basic techniques, but then after that, it's up to you to make something beautiful.
I think what it is very important to have a feeling of the place. I think what you're saying, right? To have a feeling of the place, and then how are you going to transport your audience to this place? And so visually, in a sense, and I think that's kind of like a summary of your experience,
sure.
Yes.
I do want to expand on that, because I think the subject matter often dictates. There's certain subject matter where the filmmaker's presence in position on it is appropriate. And there's certain subjects where it's maybe more appropriate to allow the subject, the information, the what's in front of you, speak rather than you impose on it. In the course of my film, I felt it was very important to allow the subject to be to not impose stylistically, overimpose on the subject. Pieter has a different subject, a different approach. So I think part of that, so this idea that you're trying to create some sort of aesthetic beauty, if that's your aesthetic, and it's something that I heard in Pieter's answer, if it's your aesthetic, that's a part of it, you know, what feels true to you. But to try to replicate some aesthetic that's outside of you, or to impose on the subject some aesthetic that may not be suggested by what you're actually filming. So it isn't just place, but I think it's actually also the subject. Is it information? Are you following words? Is that what's important? Is that what you're trying to convey, as opposed to necessarily images? Now, obviously, cinema is about images as well, but sort of.
Well, okay, so this kind of wraps up our 2016 series of talks, Dialogue with Filmmakers. I urge you to, maybe when you leave, Catherine is here, maybe you can leave her your email address or contact information in a box outside, and we will keep you informed, because next year we're going to have the same thing.
Can I make, yes? If you're interested in following The Witness on Facebook, it's The Witness Film. Well, it's extraordinarily helpful. As we all know, this is all about word of mouth. We don't have that kind of marketing campaigns and promotional budgets. So it's The Witness Film. If you can follow it on Twitter, it's at The Witness Film. And the website is kittygenovesefilm.com. Mm-hmm. I don't know how they follow you.
On Facebook, mine is The Land of the Enlightened, the entire title. And we have also a website, www.thelandoftheenlightened.com. Mm-hmm.
I think your film has an additional screening, right? There's three screenings now.
Apparently,
yes. I there might still be tickets for the third screening. So
I would also at my screening, and you might find the same thing. Both of our screenings were sold out, but at the actual screening, there were empty seats. So I would, if you're inclined, show up. I'm sure you'll get in. I mean. You know, they're all hundreds, whatever the number of seats. It just, people don't show up, and then I'm sure they fill the seats. So, we rather have a full crowd. So come and also introduce yourself. Say you were at this. Come up to us afterwards, please. Say hi. We love it. That's why we come to the festivals, to sort of meet you all, and thank you all for coming tonight and you know, attending.
And you'll be meeting the audience, right, after that?
Oh, we'll do a Q&A afterwards, and we'll stay for as long as you want us to stay. So happy to talk.
Great. Well, thank you all for coming. And one last thing, we'd like to take a picture of everybody who participated today. So come on up here, and we'll take a photo, okay? And that will be on our Facebook.